John. When John asked me to do this, he said, "Oh, just welcome the group to wonderful presentations by our colleagues, and provide a little bit of context." So I prepared to say just more than good morning to introduce you to our campus. So my name is Dele Ogunsetan. I'm chair of the Department of Population Health and Disease Prevention. I'm also professor of public health and a professor in the School of Social Ecology. And it's truly my privilege to be here today to be part of this organization of sustainability empowerment on our campus. This is a long series that's been going on for a few years, and it's brought really distinction to our campus in terms of environmental issues, the intersection of law, policy, health, and science. Many of our colleagues wish they would be here today, and I hope that we will be able to put these video recordings online at some point, because even though we're in the summer session, most students are not around, these sessions will be part of the legacy that students can benefit from for many years from now. So more than 20 years ago now, I think, when the former Prime Minister of Norway, Gro Harlem Brundtland, decided to come up with an idea for the whole world, all countries, to examine, to explore, to embrace, ultimately to change. We've captured that in this idea of sustainability. It's not surprising to most of us who are watching the United Nations deliberations at the time that picking somebody like Harlem Brundtland, who had gotten a master's in public health after practicing medicine for a long time and ultimately becoming health minister for her country, would be somebody who saw the future in many ways that has been captured in this idea of sustainability. But at the time, we didn't really think through the issues of disparities in health and environmental issues. Environmental justice is just beginning to become an academic phrase that researchers were studying. But then came how to implement this idea of sustainability. We talked about disparities across generations. So the idea was we wouldn't leave problems for future generations to solve. But as people explored this phrase, we started thinking about the current situation, not the future, not 50 years or 100 years from now, but what are those disparities that are with us now? And it's very difficult to see that outside of the health context. People don't like facilities that are going to make their real estate values go down. But it's also those reasons that people care about the health impact of those facilities in the environment, whether it's a landfill or a power plant or access to occasional social structures such as prison systems. These things have impact on the physical health and the social, psychological health of people and populations. And then came movies like Erin Brockovich and The Civil Action, and the public started to understand the significance of these disparities, and a whole field of research has been implemented because of these developments. I won't give the talk. I think we have a wonderful program today. We'll begin with Professor Dan Stokols. He is Chancellor Professor in the School of Social Ecology. Everybody wants Dan in their corner because he's done so much for team science and environmental psychology, and he's a member of the Departments of Psychology and Social Behavior, Planning, Policy, and Design, the Program in Public Health, and the Department of Epidemiology. He's going to talk to us today. We have just about an hour now before we go to break. So I would hope that we have time for questions later. And after the two presentations, but if there are clarification questions, we can ask them while the speaker is on the stage. So we'll begin with Professor Stokols' talk on the concepts of environmental justice and environmental racism in the American context. Many of the talks today, including this morning, really do fit the four themes of the areas that Professor Whiteley outlined for this program. So perspectives on the difficult global context of sustainability, case studies of compelling worldwide sustainability challenges from participating countries, and unanswered transcendent questions. I think you'll find in Dr. Stokols' presentation all of these themes presented in one way or the other. So I urge you to look for them, and we look forward to a more stimulating discussion at the end of the two presentations. Thank you, Dan.
Thank you, Deli.
I appreciate your very kind introduction. I also want to thank my colleague, Professor Whiteley, for the honor of addressing you today, and also for the honor of preceding Professor Nriago from the University of Michigan. So my comments will be a brief prelude to his talk, which will go into principles of environmental justice in more detail. But I wanted to kind of set a backdrop for his talk with a few introductory comments. And I'll begin with the theme of this conference, sustainability. And often that theme, that notion involves the idea of current generations preserving, protecting resources for the benefit of future generations. But the concept also raises the question, what is to be sustained and how is it to be sustained? And that's an issue that's come up in many of your presentations in terms of balancing economic sustainability with lifestyle, quality of life kinds of issues. So I'll begin with a definition of sustainability that was offered by James Gustav Speth from the United Nations. And he commented that sustainable development is development that not only generates economic growth, but distributes its benefits equitably, that regenerates the environment rather than destroying it, that empowers people rather than marginalizing them. It gives priority to the poor, enlarging their choices and opportunities, and provides for their participation in decision affecting them. It is development that is pro-poor, pro-nature, pro-jobs, pro-democracy, pro-women, and pro-children. So that's a tall order for sustainability, but it raises a lot of key issues. And if we think about how we're going to sustain and balance those different kinds of criteria and measures of sustainability, one can imagine trying to balance a variety of material resources and human resources. Some of the material resources include economic capital, discussed by Karl Marx and many others, financial assets for enhancing productivity and health, natural or ecological capital, which relates more to preservation, cultivation of ecological natural resources, human-made capital, which includes physical resources designed and produced by people, including buildings, vehicles, tools, and increasingly technological capital, computing and communications, equipment and infrastructure. Now on the softer human resources side, we can talk about social capital, changes in relations among persons that facilitate action, trust, human capital, changes in persons including acquisition of skills and information that enable them to act in new ways, and moral capital, which is a very important adjunct to these other kinds of resources, because we know that social capital, which involves very strong bonds between members of an in-group, can often be very destructive and detrimental to people outside of that group. So we know of gangs, we know of political parties, and brotherhoods and sisterhoods that have very strong social capital internally, but often they act out in ways that hurt others in society. So there are these balances and trade-offs between certain types of social capital that are for the good of society or may not be for the good of society. So moral capital includes investment of personal and collective resources toward the cultivation of virtue and justice. And that is an important theme of today's session. So in trying to understand sustainability from a broad ecological perspective, and that is becoming more and more central to current formulations, conceptions of environmental sustainability, societal resilience. Often people refer to ecological principles, looking at the interplay or the interrelations between different levels of analysis from individuals, groups, institutions, the global environment, and the dynamic systems principles that govern those interactions or transactions. And this ecological paradigm has evolved from the early 1800s in biology, and the biologists defined ecology as the study of the interrelations between organisms and their environments. And biological interpretations of ecology focus largely on Darwinian principles of natural selection, survival of the fittest, dominance of certain species over others in a particular biome. And in the 1920s in the US, a group of sociologists at the University of Chicago adapted these biological principles to study the city of Chicago. And they were interested in things like, why are different patterns of disorder from delinquency and public health problems distributed spatially in different ways across that community? And much of their analysis was driven by biological and economic precepts. And there was no consideration of things like, when a factory locates in the middle of a city and spews toxic smoke, people get sick, and those costs are externalized to society, but they're not borne internally by the company. So those kinds of environmental equity or justice issues were completely left out of these formulations in biology and in the early notions of human ecology, which were more economically driven, highest and best use of land, companies that are best adapted to their environment survive and profit. So in order to provide a broader conceptualization of ecological approaches to sustainability and other environmental and community problems, the notion of social ecology was born, and that's a much broader understanding of people's interactions with their environments, their surroundings. It includes the study of relations between people and their environments from a broad interdisciplinary perspective, and it gives greater attention to the social, psychological, institutional, and cultural context of people-environment relations than did earlier human ecology research. So that's a kind of backdrop for looking at sustainability from a broader, more nuanced perspective that integrates considerations of economic sustainability and success with these human quality of life issues. Now, as my former colleague at UCI, Ralph Catalano, noted in his book on community and behavior, and it was largely a look at human ecological theories, he said that costs of production that are not paid directly by the producer of a product are these externalized costs. And in that sense, because they're not paid by the producers, they are shifted away from the producer and externalized or borne by members of society as a whole, especially those who bear the brunt of the public health costs caused by the byproducts of production, such as contaminated air, water, and soil. So to tell you these things, I'm preaching to the choir. You're all very aware of these issues and sensitive to them. But the early formulations of human ecology left them out completely. So these efforts to develop a broader social ecology were trying to incorporate these concerns about environmental justice more squarely in ecological interpretations. So we have these situations where people live very close to locally undesirable land uses. Our colleague Joe Demento at UCI wrote a book on LULUs, locally undesirable land uses. And they include these kinds of proximities to toxic waste dumps, power generators that have negative health consequences. And in 1990, Professor Robert Bullard at Clark Atlanta University published a book, Dumping in Dixie. And it chronicled the disproportionate exposure of environmental toxins and carcinogens to neighborhoods of color, particularly African-American neighborhoods in Atlanta. And he showed how the rates of cancer, the rates of other health problems were much, much higher in those communities than in the more affluent white communities. And he coined the term environmental justice. Others have used it as well. The fair treatment and meaningful involvement of all people, regardless of race, color, national origin, or income, with respect to the development, implementation, and enforcement of environmental laws, regulations, and policies. So this was a starting point. And This is the homepage from the Environmental Justice Resource Center at Clark Atlanta University. It's a wonderful set of resources if you're interested in knowing more about their work and their publications. And also a major center for the study of environmental justice is at the University of Michigan, where Professor Nuriago teaches and does research, the Environmental Justice Group at Michigan. So he's probably going to say a little bit more about that group. So there are these centers in the U.S. now that are looking at environmental justice and environmental racism kinds of considerations, especially in the American context, but more broadly as well. Now, when issues of environmental injustice, or injustice, I should say, target people of color or along racial lines, that's where the sort of subset of environmental injustices referred to as environmental racism comes into play. And this is a slide from Professor Bullard's presentation. He has visited our campus on a number of occasions, also the University of Michigan. And here the people are protesting, we don't have the complexion for protection. So this is an instance where you have a kind of racist instance of environmental injustice because people of color, and especially in this case African-American communities, are being particularly targeted by those problems. So Bullard, and later Bullard and Johnson in their article in the Journal of Social Issues, defined environmental racism as any environmental policy, practice, or directive that differentially affects or disadvantages, whether intended or unintended, individuals, groups, or communities based on race or color. Environmental racism is a form of, a subtype of environmental injustice. And Professor Nuriago is going to present a much more variegated, nuanced set of principles of environmental justice after I speak. And these are some of the books that Professor Bullard and his colleagues have published at Clark Atlanta University. And this is his early book on dumping in Dixie. And some of the states in the U.S. where he has done his research on environmental racism. And when he started with this notion of environmental racism, many scholars reacted very negatively. They said that this is hyperbole, it's overdrawn, there's no such thing as environmental racism. And what his work and the work of others, such as Professor Nuriago, has accomplished is an integration of social justice principles now with environmental protection regulations in the United States. So now EPA regulations, Environmental Protection Agency regulations, incorporate issues of environmental justice and racism and strategies to mitigate those problems. In one program of research by Professor Bullard, he studied the health outcomes of people living along the Mississippi River as it flows toward the Gulf of Mexico and Louisiana. And what he found is that most of these communities that are exposed to the industrial wastes in that river are communities of color. They're low income, they're minority groups, and their rates of cancer and other health problems are much, much higher than affluent groups in the surrounding population in that state. So he documented that the cancer clusters that occur along that corridor in Louisiana along the Mississippi River. In another study in 1990, he looked at the placement of incinerators and waste dumps in the city of Houston. And he found that of those 13 locally undesirable land uses, 12 of them were in black or Hispanic neighborhoods. Only one was in a white neighborhood. Now, these are old data from 1990. But they exemplify the kinds of issues that are the concern of environmental racism, why it is that these negative land uses get placed in vulnerable populations that can't fend them off and protect themselves. So what these concepts of environmental racism and environmental justice have added to our understanding of environment and health is that they provide a much broader context. If you look at interdisciplinary work on environment and health, often you have a merging of physical environmental facts, such as exposure to air and water pollution in a neighborhood or at work, and you have biomedical facts, such as the health outcomes of people exposed to those situations. What Bullard did is he added a contextual set of social facts, widely pervasive in society, environmental justice, injustice, racism, that provides a stronger and more nuanced understanding of the relationship between environment and health. So it begins to explain why those patterns of negative health outcomes are disproportionately higher in vulnerable neighborhoods and populations. So it's a broader transdisciplinary understanding of environmental health, and in this case, exposure to pollution and cancer rates. And I'll give you one last example from a program of research that I participated in with Professor Sheldon Cohn at Carnegie Mellon University, David Krantz at Uniformed Services University in Bethesda, and Gary Evans at Cornell University. And we were interested in understanding the health effects on children, third and fourth graders, going to school in the Los Angeles corridor of the LAX International Airport. And this is a view from one of the children's schoolyards. And you can see that these planes come over very low, and the children are exposed to over 350 overflights each day at noise levels of about 100 to 120 decibels. And we found when we did a controlled study comparing four neighborhoods located under the flight path of LAX and four comparison schools located outside of the noise corridor in Los Angeles, but matched for socioeconomic status, racial composition of families in the school, et cetera, we found a number of very significant health impacts on those third and fourth graders. We found that their blood pressure, systolic and diastolic blood pressure, was significantly higher than the children living in the quiet schools. We found that certain criteria of task performance and academic achievement were lower in the noisy schools. And at that time, we were not thinking about environmental injustice issues. But in retrospect, it's a good example, a pretty clear example, of that situation in LA, because what it means is that certain neighborhoods can't avoid being close to these negatively impacting land uses. In Orange County, where we are now in California, there was a proposal to develop a major international airport at a former US Marines air station. And the community rose up, they developed websites to protest this. And in affluent Orange County, where you had that political mobilization, the original plan of the Orange County supervisors to put a big international airport right near people's homes and schools was defeated. And what we have now is a project called the Orange County Great Park, which is, I think, twice as large as Central Park in New York. So it became a very nice natural resource, a preservation of ecological capital for Orange County. But the difference between this situation in Los Angeles, in the largely black neighborhood, Ingleside and Lenox, right near the airport in LA, is that those communities couldn't mobilize that political power, that political voice. And so the best they were able to do is to achieve an out-of-court settlement with the LAX airport for sound insulation of the classrooms and the schools. So a lot of money was put into trying to abate, sound abatement processes for these structures at the schools. And we did a pre-post study during the spring before the abatement strategies were implemented, and then in the fall to see if there was any mitigation of some of those health consequences for the children. And we did find some improvement, but very minimal improvement, because after all, the children are outside much of the time and they're being exposed to that noise, even though you insulate the ceilings and the windows and that type of thing. So I'll close with that example from an American context and actually very close by in Los Angeles as a kind of prelude to Professor Nriago's talk, which I very much look forward to hearing. So at this time, I want to welcome him up and thank you very much for your attention. Appreciate it.
Let's see. Thank you, Dan.
Oh, thanks, Dan.
Are there any quick questions? John Whiteley just told me we don't have time pressure, so we can take a few questions. Yes. Dan, you're not free, so.
What's that?
We're going to take a few
questions.
Just an observation.
Yeah.
Anyone who's ever flown out of John Wayne Airport gets a pretty dramatic demonstration.
Yes. Yes. Yeah, you probably, so those of you that flew into John Wayne Airport or fly out, you'll notice that very steep incline when you take off. And that's because there are a lot of very affluent people living close to that airport in Newport Beach, and they militated against the airport to get this very unusual special regulation implemented. So all the pilots have to fly out of there at a much steeper angle than other airports. Any other questions or comments?
One more.
Yes.
I'm asking the question not because I agree with them, but I'm curious as to your response. In Schellenberg and Nordhaus's book, not the first one, but I don't remember the name of the second one, they made a compelling argument against environmental justice as an activist endeavor because they say it was too particularistic and it prevented us from dealing with the larger issues of injustice and the broader issues of all of the results of racism and poverty. And they say it makes us unnecessarily focus on an individual and not the big picture. Are you familiar with their argument?
I'm kind of a small wins person. I feel like if you can make headway in drawing attention to these issues around the environment, and granted, issues of racism are much broader and are go well beyond negative environmental structures and toxins. But I think that that movement in this country in particular, in terms of our regulatory system, was extremely valuable because you had this merging of the environmental protection movement with the social justice movement. And I think if we hadn't had that activism by Bullard and others that have come after him, those problems would have gone unrecognized or neglected. So I agree with their argument that we need a broad, comprehensive approach, but I also think it's valuable to make some headway around particular instances of discrimination against women, discrimination against particular races, and hopefully together, collectively, those advances accumulate into societal progress. But I think it's very hard to accomplish that in one fell swoop all at once. So, but it's an interesting point.
Any other? I always say that there are splitters and lumpers. And lumping all of the consequences of environmental racism or injustice can help us see the big picture, but my view is to really make impact in policy very specifically. It's a better idea to look at different incidences and categories. That would be my response to the argument. But yes.
And I'd also say, if any of you are interested in references to some of the work I presented, like the airport study or the framework looking at material and human types of capital, let me know and I can send you those papers.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Appreciate it.